Their music was the sound of a new generation, selling 40 million albums worldwide and amassing 16 top 40 hits. The Doobie Brothers are instantly recognisable as the sound of the 1970s.
Well, Tom, Pat, it is fantastic to chat to you guys. You'll be getting ready to pack your bags soon to come to Australia because you're playing Blues Fest. Are you excited?
Yeah, we're looking forward to it. It's been a while.
It's going to be great. Going to have fun.
Have you guys been to Byron Bay before on any of your visits to Australia?
We've played there twice at two festivals.
Still, to this day, it's got that special sort of Byron vibe. It's a bit hippie, you know, a bit carefree. Do you like that sort of vibe?
Sure. I mean, a lot of people are having a good time. It's all good.
Yeah, it's like California a lot, you know, to be honest with you. It even looks like California. Palm trees, eucalyptus, gum trees.
Yeah, people also very at one with nature. I'm wondering if it might inspire you, take you back to your Free Willy days on the Toulouse Street album insert.
Never heard of it that way before.
Might be time to relive that.
Free Willy, I get it. Willie Nelson, are you talking about?
Yeah.
We're going to free Willy. He just got arrested. We're going to get him, break him out.
Jesus is just all right with me. Jesus is just all right.
I first got to meet you guys when you were on tour here in Australia in 1995.
When you were turning out hit after hit in the early years, was there a lot of pressure on you to keep that up?
It just happened.
And we discussed, of course, how you came up with the name Doobie Brothers, and you tried to tell me it came from Romper Room.
In the States, there's a children's TV program called Romper Room. And they have the Doobies and the Don't Bees.
Come on!
It's well known. Frank Sinatra stole it in a Romper Room and wrote a song, you know, Doobie Doobie something, and then we smoked it. And we rolled it up and smoked it.
I wasn't going to accept that it came from a children's television program. You acknowledge that back in the 70s you enjoyed the odd Doobies. Do you still enjoy the odd Doobie in your 70s?
I gave it up. I gave it up for Lent.
You did? Pat's not commenting, I notice.
I'm not commenting.
Pleading the fifth.
I don't want to get in trouble, but I do know Willie Nelson is a good friend of mine, so I'll let you draw your own conclusions.
Don't you feel it growing day by day? Keep up, get rid of the news.
During lockdown, you guys were one of the things that kept me going. The performances you did from your living rooms were extraordinary. Like, they were just amazing. Did that keep you guys sane when you couldn't go on the road?
I think the fact that we were able to get back and get together via the internet and do those songs was kind of a relief. It was a lot of fun too, because, you know, it took up time. You did all your parts. Everybody did their parts at their own house. And then John put them together, Don McPhee put them together in his studio. And the video part was done by a guy back in Nashville. It worked out pretty well.
Listen to the music.
Your harmonies are always so perfect when you're all on stage together, but, you know, you were all over the United States when you were doing that, literally, weren't you? And still just sounded amazing.
It was an experiment. You know, I don't think we knew what it was going to be like, to be honest with you. I mean, we've done little bits and pieces of recording things and emailing them on, Dropboxing them or whatever to other people, but nothing quite like that. What did we start with, Tom? Was Listen to the Music?
Blackwater. We also did Let It Rain with Peter Frampton.
Let it rain, let it rain, let your love rain down on me.
I'd forgotten how many we did. We did so many. The guy who did the video, Rob Arthur, that's actually Peter Frampton's keyboard player.
All right.
Believe it or not. So that was kind of cool. You know, he played on Let It Rain also, you know, with us. But it was fun. You know, it was creative, and like Tom said, it kept us going.
All the people, all the time, go!
So you're celebrating incredibly your 50th anniversary, albeit a bit late because of COVID. What's it like to still be playing to fans, especially after not being able to for that time? Is there a new appreciation of it, almost?
For me, it's almost like you never left. Once you get out there and start rolling, this is a different kind of tour because Mike's on it, so we've got a much more broad amount of music that we're putting out every night. But the crowds, I think, are the ones especially, who were really happy to be back out and enjoying shows again. They're pretty enthusiastic. They've been great. He came from somewhere back in the long ago.
Sentimental fool, don't see trying hard to... You mentioned Mike McDonald, of course. What's it like for the two of you to share the stage and to bring that whole Doobies repertoire together?
I think everybody's really having a great time. I mean, I know I am. We've done it before, but the last time we did it as a tour was 1995. That is literally the last time we toured with Mike. We've done one-offs with him, corporate gigs, that kind of thing. This is over 2 hours, 20 minutes worth of music, and it's a huge swath of all the tunes that this band has put out, both songs that everybody knows, which were, you know, hits or whatever, but also some deep cuts, because we have a large catalog to choose from, a lot of songs.
Does everyone still get on? Because traveling together is always tricky.
The tension is pervasive.
Is it?
I've had to kick so many butts since I've been out there. It's been tough.
It's like, don't look me in the eye here, don't look me in the eye there. What do you think, if you had to distill it down to a sentence, makes the Doobie Brothers' music so spectacular?
A lot of people sing harmonies. That's always been one of the things that was a hallmark of this band. But also, everybody comes from a different musical background, and that comes through in the music. You know, for instance, I come up from blues, rock and roll, R&B, that sort of thing. Pat has a huge background in what they call Americana now. They used to call it bluegrass, and also rock and roll and other things. And we have a lot of the same influences, but we also have some that are a little different, and that gives you different capabilities musically.
Tom, the excesses that sometimes come with rock and roll got the better of you for a time, but you came through. Are you grateful that you made it through that time when, you know, quite a few of your peers didn't?
Yeah, because I wouldn't be here talking to you now if I hadn't, and I wouldn't be doing what we're doing right now.
What gave you the strength to keep going? What got you through?
You know, I'll be honest with you, other than regretting the fact that I had to go through it, I just kept on going. I didn't think about it a lot. I just kept doing like one foot in front of the other, and before you know it, we were back together and on the road for another 30 plus years, and just kept on going.
We're lucky enough that you're going to do some sideshows around the country as well, so people who can't get to Byron, you're going to come to a few of our cities. Do you have any favourite places in Australia or any tales you remember from being here over the years that you'd care to share? Anything suitable for morning television that you can tell me about?
So we're in Brisbane. I walk out of the hotel room with one of our roadies, Mark Brown. This guy was our roadie. And we're walking along, and this guy is in a taxi cab, and he says, "Hi, hi, mate, you want to go down and see Billy Thorpe? Billy Thorpe is playing down on the Gold Coast in a big club." And I go, "Billy Thorpe, I know who Billy Thorpe is." He goes, "Yeah, he's a mate of mine. If you like, come along, I'll drive you out there." And I go, "Okay, let's go." So it was Noel. Remember Noel? So we get in the car, we drive down to the Gold Coast and meet Billy Thorpe. And so we saw the show, getting ready to go back. And we go, "Well, I'm with Mark." I go, "Where's Noel? Have you seen Noel?" He goes, "No, he was out here a while ago." So we're looking, all the club is emptying. You know, it's a big club, like 1,200 seats, a lot of, you know, pretty big size, good size. So we're looking around, "Where's Noel?" So we finally look, and we see him laying on some seats. He's passed out.
Oh.
He's gonna drive us back to Brisbane. So I go, "Come on, Noel, we gotta go." He goes, "Oh, I can't drive, I'm too drunk." I go, "Come on, you gotta drive. How are we gonna get back?" He goes, "You're gonna have to drive." So we put him in the back seat. It was before, you know, a GPS. So we're just following signs, driving on the other side of the road for me, you know. I'm driving this cab, a yellow taxi cab. Noel, he just slept the whole way. We get to the hotel, we park the cab, we leave him sitting in the hotel. Well, later that next day, he's like, "How'd you get back?" I go, "How do you think we got back?" "Oh, I don't know. I woke up in the back of the cab. You know, I go, yeah, I drove. He goes, no, you didn't. You know, I go, yeah.
That is such a good story. I love it. I'd love to track down Noel. And I've got to say, your Australian accent's spot on. Hey, it's been such a pleasure and a privilege to catch up with you both today. I can't wait to see you in the flesh when you get here and see you on stage.
That's it? You're kicking us off?
Well, no. I mean, if you've got more yarns like that, I can stay all day.
We're just getting started.
Just getting warmed up. No, it's been so great to catch up with you. People are going to go nuts seeing you all together on stage at Blues Fest and around. Thank you so much for your time today, Pat and Top.
Thank you.